And I, we were talking about this 4,500 level, how it was a positive thing that the market had sort of, when it had hit that level, it had bounced up from there. Well, now we're down at 4,479. I guess if we breach that earthquake low of 4,477, where do we look to from there?
So a number of things happening today on the technical front. You mentioned 4,500 points has been a strong area for the market in the past. In fact, over the past 2 years, we've seen the market bounce off this level 5 times now. We've actually broken through that, so that is quite a bearish signal. We've also seen a new low for this correction at 4,479 points. That means we're into the 10th week of the correction, and since the peak that we've seen in April, the market has now fallen by 10%. Not only that, we also have a look at key technical levels for some of the biggest stocks on our market, and the biggest stock on our market, of course, is BHP Billiton. Just the fall that we saw in its share, this represented a 10-point loss on the Aussie share market today. And if we have a look at the 52-week chart of BHP Billiton, this is what we've been watching over the past week. You can see this very strong support line in place. Unfortunately, the fall today breaking that support line, pointing to further losses in our biggest stock on the market. So that's quite a negative signal in terms of technicals. Also, if we have a look at technicals of other key markets, the Shanghai Composite is one that's very closely followed by the Australian market because of our exposures to the commodities. So if we have a look at the Shanghai market, 2,700 points was a key level on the Shanghai Composite. And if we have a look at the 2,700 point mark, unfortunately today on the Shanghai Composite, we've seen that very clearly breach. And then if we have a look at the US market, we saw the S&P 500 closing at 1,360 points. 1,350 points is the low that the US market could reach from the Japan disaster. So that's a key support level that the market's coming up towards. So a very important time. We still haven't reached a new low for the year, but 4,477 points is the mark that we're going to be watching in the next couple of sessions. If we see a break of that, we could be testing the 2010 lows at 4,175 points.
Julia, let's talk some company news that's out there today. ERA, Energy Resources of Australia, that Rio Tinto unit, was forecasting a loss, but I believe there's been a bit of an improvement on that front.
Nadine, if I can just add something just very quickly. I think the reason why markets are falling is not because Greece is less than 2% of Eurozone GDP, but the risk of contagion. It's the fear of systemic risk which is driving markets at the moment. We saw credit markets really seizing up after the Lehman collapse, and what we saw were the problems really being deferred and a lot of traders talking about the end game, because these problems have now moved from private debt balance sheets to now public debt balance sheets. Now, we are talking about Greece, but it's not so much fear about Greece and its GDP because its contribution is quite small. The risk is of contagion, and if you have a look at where this Greece debt is being held, well, about $500 million by Japanese banks, about $600 million by Spanish banks. If we have a look at the French banks, it's just around that $20 billion level, and then if you have a look at German banks, it's about $26.3 billion. We've also got Moody's putting on a negative watch, the three largest banks in France as well. So it's really systemic risk that the market is worried about. If that disappears overnight, the market is going to be rally, but it's not so much the growth aspect of Greece, but really the contagion effect that the market's worried about.
Absolutely. And then, Julia, when we bring that story home, I guess for Australian bank stocks, for example, even though they're not directly invested in the Greece situation themselves, we could see, you know, the cost of wholesale funding, for example, rising as we did at the height of the credit crunch in the global financial crisis. Is that also part of the concern?
Absolutely. If you have a look at the big four banks in Australia, the banking sector lost 2.2%. That's a massive one-day fall for the big four banks, which are seen as some of the strongest in the world. But if you have a look at the funding mix of our big four banks, about 60% is funded from retail deposits, but about 40% come from the wholesale funding markets, and that's where our banks are at risk. If we do see the credit markets once again having problems, if we do see systemic risk and contagion, then the banks are going to be sold down because of those concerns. So if we have a look at the big four banks all trading lower today, keeping a close eye on the situation in Greece, because if we do see a Greece default happen, I think Standard & Poor's has a 1 in 3 chance of that happening, or if we see a haircut of 50% to 70%, then we are going to see our funding costs being impacted, and that's where the banks and I guess the losses in terms of the bank share price and profitability comes in.
Yeah, and so Julia, you're saying basically it's wrong to sort of gloss over these weaknesses that are out there, these, you know, the Greek debt crisis, some of the questions over the US economy. You sort of put stock in the fact that, yeah, things are quite negative out there.
Well, if you have a look at the Greek crisis, you know, French banks hold about $20 billion worth of Greece debts. You've got three of the largest French banks now facing either a one-notch or a two-notch downgrade by Moody's. It means that if we do see a default by Greece, we are going to have to see our banks probably trying to raise capital, get their capital adequacy back up in the market, and that's going to have a worldwide impact. So a contagion effect is really what's driving that banking sector at the moment. Of course, global growth concerns as well. The other option for Greece, if they don't do a default or a haircut, is to run by that austerity measure and IMF EU bailout. But of course, that has implications in terms of the country of Greece. And we've seen civil unrest because of that and protests against that austerity. So on one hand, we have austerity and a potential EU IMF bailout, which isn't popular by Greek citizens. We're seeing protests and, of course, a lack of confidence and a loss of confidence in the Greek government. And on the other hand, we see the potential for a haircut or some sort of restructuring, which could have a contagion effect.